going to try and have a conversation with just one microphone. Keep it free flowing, lightweight, spontaneous, natural.
With cue cards.
With cue cards. So, PJ very kindly asked me to give some kind of a talk on something, and we thought it actually might be better for us to just bend some stuff around, maybe have a bit of interaction with the audience if you guys wanted to ask some questions. Maybe it might be best if we both spoke a little bit about our backgrounds first, give you some context, and we'll take it from there. You want to go first? I've already spoken. Natural.
Hi, I'm Dylan. I'll start at the beginning. I started working in tech about 15 years ago at Crate & Barrel, which is a housewares store, which is normally where people start in tech. Spent a bunch of time there, and then worked at a company called Friendless that makes t-shirts, which is, I think, the next logical evolution for technology is housewares and t-shirts. Spent a little bit of time there, ended up as the VP of engineering towards the end, and then left, and did the next logical thing after housewares and t-shirts, which was as the director of engineering for the 2012 Obama re-election campaign. So, natural progression there. After that, turns out when that's over, I get fired. So that was fun. Started a company doing sort of the next wave of commerce stuff. A lot of mobile, a lot of what is now called contextual commerce. And about a year ago, that whole company joined Braintree PayPal. And now I'm a director of engineering or some such thing at PayPal.
Director of engineering of 300 people.
Yeah.
It's more people than in this room. I started about 20 years ago, a little bit older. Didn't work for a home or a store. Although my first job was stacking shelves in the supermarket. Just on that, first jobs, hands up. Anybody ever work in a supermarket? Bar? Cleaning toilets. You didn't. Anything that is as far away as the privileged life we have in tech right now. Alright. It's good to remember what your roots and where you came from. We'll come back to that. I worked for agencies over the years. About 10 years ago I started working for myself as a freelance developer. Any freelance developers here? Nobody's a freelancer, seriously.
Saves!
They all work for Wayne, clearly. freelance development and stuff. Did you ever do freelance stuff?
I did.
Yeah, stuff. Because, you know, you might know how to write code, but what it goes to actually convince people to give you money.
That's terrible.
No. And people come up with all sorts of bullshit excuses. Oh, check is in the post, or you know, don't do our payment run this week, it'll be next week. Can you give me another 10 days? You know? I'm not a bank. I wouldn't give you those credits. A freelance developer, then I started a small dev shop, 5 people, and we built product for mostly startups. Building product for startups, as it turns out, is probably worse than freelancing, because startups don't have money. Trying to get paid from them, even if they have money, it's no guarantee they'll be around next week. Anybody build product for startups? Hands up. Diversify. Get into the enterprise. After that though, we tried to build a bunch of products, failed miserably. At one point our flagship product was a URL shortener. Remember when that shit was on the grounds? URL shorteners. But ours was the first in the world to offer analytics on the number of clicks he got. But that was basically it, just like how many clicks. that was it. And then Binti came along and they raised $2 million. We're like, don't even know how you can monetize this shit. Okay, next. Then we built a platform as a service called Orchestra, which was for PHP community. And after a little while of that, we joined Engine Yard and opened up a so I started up this thing a few years later called Cohort, which PJ very kindly allowed me to sponsor, which wasn't much, but I appreciate it. And Cohort is kind of what LinkedIn would be if it was started up today, but without all the crap. So just focusing on relationships, not contacts, focusing on how well people know each other, so strength of friend-to-friend relationships, and then what people can do, so how you bring people together around particular opportunities. And you know a little bit about Cohort, because you're one of my investors. So, with that aside, where should we start? I'm going to hand this mic to you now. Do you want to start with the mic covers?
Sure.
What were your morning paths? How was your flight?
Your flight was great, thanks for asking.
PJ very helpfully provided us with some cards and some prompts on it that might be interesting topics of conversation. There was some not so good ones that we left on the table. What's your favorite band? What is your favorite band?
My favorite band is...
Thanks.
My favorite band is a band out of Philadelphia from the 80s that's still around, called the Dead Note Men. The Dead Note Men, they're amazing. That's right.
Just to get a sense of the audience, hands up if you write code on a daily basis. Hands up if you test code on a daily basis. Not your own code. Anybody do support? Anybody not do any of those things? Are we talking customer service? Are we talking design? Of course, sorry, design. Designers. One designer, seriously, one designer in the whole room. Nice job, PJ. Okay, well, this will make this first question, which is, it's kind of a loaded question from PJ. I think he knew what he was doing when he asked this. I think this is a bit of a trolling question. What is the right programming language for startups? What is the right programming language for startups, though?
So, on the Obama campaign, it was kind of like a startup, 18 months beginning to end, going from zero to 300 deployed products. The only thing that really mattered was that we could get more people in to help. So, we just chose easy things. So we had a bunch of things that were in Ruby, a bunch of things that were in Python, and a bunch of things that were in PHP. And anything else, we didn't have.
And how did that, those decisions that you made at the beginning impact as the campaign progressed?
So the reasoning for that was, in our case, what we needed was we needed to be able to get people up and running as quick as possible. So making sure that there was something that anybody that walked in the door could help with immediately, and also sort of fundamentally having this core idea that, like, we're not clever, we're not trying to do, like, the coolest, most intense technology, but, like, solving real problems with straightforward code. So, like, we don't necessarily need anything beyond what we get from any sort of easy programming language, to put it crudely. And so, like, really making it so that it was more focused on the team itself. Like, how do we make sure that people can access this stuff and actually, like, be able to understand it quickly, and it worked out pretty well. You know, towards the end, we had a couple of things that were far more specialized that we needed to branch out, but really, not much at all. You know, we got to some pretty serious scale. I think we processed on our payment processing stuff like 200 million some dollars in donations, and on a little PHP app that we had two people working on. To an extent, like, the language, in my opinion, doesn't matter so much so long as you can get people in that understand it.
Yeah, Yeah, that's kind of an observation I've witnessed myself firsthand. I mean, it's pretty interesting if you're to think about that particular project as if it was an actual startup, and you go from zero to 200 million in donations or revenue in what? In what period of time are you talking about?
That was in about 12 months.
12 months. That's not like, that's a parallel. A startup goes from zero to 200 million in 12 months. And yet, there is this is one thing that people feel though these days is probably people who don't build product or haven't built product in a long time, and they obsess about the technology that's only built in. This is a pretty good argument for hiring generalists and taking a right tool for the job approach. And it kind of correlates with the rise in just a general polyglot approach over the last number of years. I remember when I started out as a PHP developer, it was kind of your identity. And I think for some people it probably still is, and that's fine, but those people are also probably like core to the PHP project, right? And you probably say the same for other languages. Does anybody agree with what we're saying here, or think that we're talking crap? Anybody got any opinion about that?
We publish it?
I know, which one did you clap for you? Is it a delay there?
Sounds good.
Sounds good. But I think like this Swiss Army knife approach is like, all the tools are out there, it's really just down to the problem you're trying to solve. Like, that's way more important. Like, are you working on the right thing? Is it something that you could create value from? Whether that is a profit, if it's a startup organization, or if it's an impact, if it's a social entrepreneurship, or a social operation. And what creating value, what's the problem solving? What is the shortest path to create something that starts to create value, or to solve that problem? And at some point in the future, if you require specialists, or if you really need to use a particular technology or tool, aspect of the stack, you can do that. But if you don't get to the point where you've proven that something is useful or valuable, then you never even go there.
Yeah, so it's sort of, I'm probably going to say exactly the same thing you just did, but essentially, if you're not actually focused on the end user and like making sure that you're solving the problem instead of focusing all of your time on like what's the right technology for what I think the problem is, then you just end up down this path where you're building for all the wrong reasons. And you know, based on my experience, which is sort of riddled with failure along the way, like if you're not actually focused on the customer and the problem itself, and you know, get too sort of bogged down in like how do I want to solve this? How can I be clever in coming up with a good solution instead of like actually focusing on like what's going to help these people? Then you just lead straight to failure.
Funny thing is that's just like a modern version of the customer's always right, just kind of apply it differently. And at the end of the day, if you pay attention to your customers, you probably figure something out. And we're probably not saying something that hasn't already said before.
The trick is you gotta listen though.
Sorry, bud.
Solve problems, I think. I think like all we all love is sort of in reaction to that, but if we do that, like if we just sort of follow the best practices and ignoring the actual problem that we're trying to solve, then we're not actually doing what we should be doing, which is applying those best practices inside of solving those problems.
Moving on. So you're given your 18 months or so that you were active in, what would you call it, political enterprise software, I guess. Do you have any thoughts on just where things are today?
Does everybody know the comic, I think it's called Gun Show, which is the Mrs. Fine Dog?
No, I have no idea what that is. I'm from Ireland. There is a world outside this country.
Do they have the internet there?
Well, we only got electricity last week, so we're trying to catch up. To be sure.
I'll talk super briefly about this. And I'm going to try to pull it back into technology, which is much the same way that like we sort of separated out the like how we do things from why we do things in technology. I feel like we have a lot of that same thing happening in the world in general, where it's becoming more polarized about like be winning instead of being right or moving things forward. So that's about as much of a stance as I'm going to take, well, with a microphone in my hand.
Find me later.
How about you? What do you think about this?
Well, you know, I'm an outsider. Ireland depends heavily on U.S. investment, so we're about to go and make a fast exit. No, bear with me for a minute. Ireland depends heavily on U.S. investment, right? Not just in terms of money coming in, but in terms of the skills and experience and expertise. As an island nation on the edge of Europe, we probably otherwise wouldn't have access to. And I am a huge fan of this country.
This is amazing.
PJ sent me this a long time ago. I'm a huge fan of this country. I've been to the United States more than any other country. And I travel a lot. Probably been here about 25, 26 times. I also come from a country that has been divided for a long time, both in terms of culture, but you know, also in terms of real war, and in terms of real terrorism. And we're not like that anymore. We made friends with our neighbors, but so we pay a lot of attention to conversations that happen in this country, because they affect us. Maybe that's a bit selfish, but we're a small country of 5 million people, can't really have it any other way. I'm not going to be political, but whatever you want to vote. As a fan of America, as a fan of Americans, some of the nicest people I've ever met, it breaks my heart to see a potential where country is so heavily divided. You could argue that this country has been divided for a long time on different fronts. This is a different kind of territory. So what I would say is this country is not really great. Don't fuck it up. So I'm gonna leave this on because PJ gave this to me. And I told him last night I didn't bring it, and he genuinely, you could see the hurt in his eyes, he was holding back the tears. Moving on. Why are people mean? This is a genuine question of DJ Glenn McGarfers. Why are people mean?
like one of the things that you were just talking about is like the separation. Like I think that we have that. We're seeing that politically and in the world, but we see it a lot in terms of like even on our in our lives on a small scale inside of a company. You know, you see the separation between like roles. You see the separation between, you know, engineers are going to focus on the code, and you know, other people are going to talk to the customers, and you know, you build this wall between every single part of your life. So like whether we're talking about politics on a grand scale, or we're talking about like just inside of a small team, even, you focus on the things that you think you need to focus on, and you lose sight of the big picture. And if you're not reminded that other people exist and that people matter, it becomes really easy to just focus on yourself. And I'm weirdly optimistic, so just bear with me where this logic makes no sense. But I have to believe that everybody cares, but they just forget, because they don't have to interact with everybody, and then, so they're completely unintentionally complete and total assets.
I like that line of thinking where you're giving them the benefit of the doubt. You know, I mean, if we give up on if we assume everybody's an asshole, we may as well give up on humanity, right? We know not everybody's an asshole, and even when you do it, like I was an asshole last night, right? you don't mean to be, right? We're all human, we don't mean to be. But the thing that you talk about there is just like it takes your own visual context, right? I've definitely encountered this in the past, where out of sight, out of mind, greatly impacted the effectiveness of an overall organization, greatly impacted the effectiveness of teams working together. Because when you don't see or communicate directly with people who are working on the same type of thing, it can have a big impact in everything you do. Never mind culturally, which is probably the biggest area. And so, but this is a really important point of conversation, because as teams and organizations become more remote, more distributed, what are the types of things that people should be thinking about when it comes to ensuring that meanness doesn't creep in, or effectively that there's a culture that supports it and more human-friendly work environment?
So there's a lot of different vectors for meanness. So I mean, like just sort of inside of a team, like there's a lot of things, particularly, I mean, Modest, which is the company that I started, was about 50% remote and about 50% in Chicago. And we had to do a lot of things to make sure that there was like real human connection, which is, it's a hard thing. It's a very hard thing to sort of make sure that you can have that that bonding and that humanness that you strive for in a team while being sort of spread out across the country or the world.
Just hands up, remote. Anybody works remote? Anybody works nice. For with remote people? You may not be remote yourself. Sorry. Yeah. All right. So, guys.
Pro tip: if you work with remote people and you don't think of yourself as remote, you're thinking about it wrong.
Yeah, nice.
Because either everybody's remote or they're the other. But like, so there's a lot of stuff like intra-team to be able to do that. But then there's also, and those are addressed. It's hard, but there's a lot of sort of easy things that you can do. You know, Slack for more communication, and a good way to be able to sort of escalate conversations. And it's like, if Slack is not working, you should be able to say, wait, I think that we need to actually see faces for this, and you know, be able to graduate at a higher fidelity and everything. So it's like Slack or phone call or Hangouts or let's actually get in the same space, exactly. And being able to do that kind of stuff and building that into the culture so that we have not only the communication aspect of it, but also bringing people together however much we can. Because there is no substitute for like actually being in the same room, at least once in a while. So there's that side of it, but there's another part. We talked a little bit about this last night, but it's the how do we make sure that sort of inside of the the industry, inside of our roles, that there is that humanness built in. So I work with a lot of new engineers, and they are taught through all of their experiences that they know better. And that, like, their job is to come in and, like, solve all the problems because you're an engineer. That's what you do. Exactly. It breeds this idea of, like, well, I'm an engineer, so I'm smarter than you.
Yeah. No, totally. Hands up, who's smarter than everybody else? Well, I mean, hands up, seriously, though, hands up, who's smarter? This is hands up who has encountered that mindset. Okay. Hands up who maybe in a younger version of themselves was that person. Come on, I think we can all. Like we're given tools that come in and solve problems, and that gives us a bias that makes us think, oh, you know, I'm just gonna I wrote this SaaS product that creates a workflow around, I don't know, managing widgets. I'm going to write medical software now because I know how to fix people.
So I had a wonderful experience on the campaign where we thought we were smarter than everybody. And we were like, well, we can solve all of these political problems by building better software so that the campaign would be better. And so we went down that path for a little bit and it didn't work at all. We had an advisor who was great, one of the best technologists in the world, who talked to us and said, well, did you go into the campaign manager's office and tell them that you're an engineer? Like, that is the answer. Like, no, we're engineers. And so, clearly.
Yeah, it's, and the other thing that we talked about related to that, though, is that if this is the kind of tone that has been set for young people coming into the organization or into the industry. And if, you know, nobody has checked that perception along the way, what are the things that, you know, you could do as a team member with that person or as a lead for that person or just as somebody maybe with a bit more experience in the organization? What are the types of things you could do to kind of check that perception?
So, I think that it's interesting because it's not even just checking that perception, but like literally we're reinforcing it constantly where it's like, oh, engineers get all of these perks, but like, oh, you work support? Sorry.
Yeah.
Like, you know, the conference benefit isn't for you, or like the, you know, no work Fridays doesn't apply, or oh, you want to be remote? Can't do that for support. You know, those things sort of it exist constantly. But so there's a lot of things that you can do to the organization to sort of fix that. But one of the, I keep going back to the, like, reminding people that they exist. So when I started at Crate & Barrel, I came in and I was like, I'm an engineer, I'm super smart. And they were like, go work in a store for a month. And I was like, but I'm an engineer. And it was the most important thing that possibly could happen. Same thing when I started at Threadless, I spent a week in the warehouse, just shipping orders so that you actually, you know what the problem is, and you see how hard everybody's job is.
Many people work in a company that has a marketing team. Seriously? Oh. Okay. How many people have worked in a company that has a marketing team? How many people think they can do marketing better than their marketing team? Have you actually sat down with the marketing team? Oh, you shouldn't have put your hand up.
I know I can do better.
Well, we can always do better. Congratulations. My point is that I've encountered that the same kind of thing so many times over the last 20 years, whereas as developers, especially if you're building something that is for developers and you're a developer, you know, what the fuck does marketing even do? I know PJ has definitely never said that. Ever said the fuck is marketing? Never said that. I definitely have. I have said that. But it's fair because you know, they have a job to do as well. But this type of attitude is what leads to siloing and walls and locking down conversations, leads to a toxic culture, and makes remote work even harder. Because if you've got multiple components of a team, regardless of the roles, and they don't inherently trust each other to do the job that they're hired to do, then something's going to break sooner or later, right? Can we move on? How are we doing for time? We're good. Do you want to like tell us how much time we have left? We don't understand. We got 1 minute left. 1 minute. We'll do one more card.
Sure. Sure, we can cover something in a minute. Yeah, any questions?
Going back a little bit, we're talking about languages, but more in terms of like front-end framework, which is like the main thing now. Like, would you say that you're starting with something? Do you need one? Or if you don't have one, are you like hindering your user experience to the point that you're making your usability smooth?
Well, we couldn't have that decision to make ourselves for the bottom line in the mobile context. CodeDaze has a mobile interface, and we had to go native or go hybrid. And if you go hybrid, what framework are you going to use? And at the end of the day, whatever one got us as far as we could with the least amount of capital, and in the short space of time, was the one that we went with, knowing which was Ionic, which uses Angular. So, knowing full well that it would be a bit of a learning curve, and really when you throw them all up into the air, they'll all more or less come down in the same way. And knowing full well that at some point we might want to go native and have to throw all those out, but if we don't get to the point where we can prove value, then none of that matters. So the pragmatic decision for us was, well, this guy working for us already knows Angular, and Ionic is built on Angular, and it does 99% of what we needed to do on a mobile device, an iPhone, and it's mostly compatible with Android. Let's just do that. I'm sure there were things as we were going on, like, oh, maybe we should go for React, but make a decision, you go with it, and in the day, it's a race to create value in a short space of time. Prove that there's something useful there, and that's valuable to people. And then you can take it from there. I don't think it's a problem throwing code out. I don't think that should be a controversial thing to say.
I think it should be the expectation. Like, when you're talking about having that pragmatic decision up front, like, the expectation should be that 2 years from now, all of that code's going to be gone anyway. So, like, taking that pragmatic decision now, like, so long as you can actually, one of two things is going to happen. Either you're going to demonstrate value, you're going to grow the team, and you're going to reinvest on something that is, like, exactly what you want. Based on actual usage, or it's not going to work at all, and you're going to fail, and that code's getting thrown away anyway.
So it's like that philosophical question about the ship. That if a ship is built and then the plank on the ship is changed one after each other, is it still the same ship or not? And it's kind of like how the human body works with cells, but the code is just like that as well, because like you said to your son, blah 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 blah. Okay, you sure? One last question, if there is one. Stretch it. Come on. This is your chance to rest PJ's head. Even just throw us a random question. We're just all over time now. Here we go.
What's the one thing you can tell us that PJ doesn't want us to know?
Oh. Has been made into Dublin, let me see.
It was never done.
I'll tell you the one thing that PJ doesn't want you to know. This is genuine. He's way smarter than he pretends. He really is. That is true. I've worked with him for a good while. He's a good friend. He's way smarter than he pretends. Never underestimate that fucker. We'll leave there. Thank you very much for listening to the round. Yeah.